morning, and he calls us to do that, to offer up our worship to him. There we go. And so we just ask that you would stand and join us this morning as we sing to him.
The joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he. And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. The earth is filled with his glory. We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he. And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. The earth is filled with his glory. And it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. And it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. The earth is filled with his glory. And it's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. And it's rising up all together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with his glory. The earth is filled with his glory.
This next song may be a little bit new to some people in the congregation, so we would ask that you listen as we sing the first verse, and then we will join back in with the first verse again and invite you to sing along with us then. Thank you.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart.
Please sing with us.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end of all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. Look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, what a perfect, spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God.
Thank you. You may be seated.
To see you. All right, you can hear me. Thank you. Glad that you could jump in with us this morning at Duxbury Church. Pleasure to have you with us in person and online. Grateful just to be able to encourage you a bit this morning from God's Word, but so glad you could be here. The first thing I wanted to mention is just thank you. You guys have been just generous with your time and with your resources. We were able to help many families in the area with coats this fall, this winter. We've been able to help people with toys. A ton of boys and girls here in our community, boys and girls here in Boston area. In the foster community, would not have any gifts this Christmas without your generosity. And so yesterday, actually, I think it was Friday evening, from 6 to 8, there was kind of an open invitation here for those in the foster community, those children in need here in our area to come through, kind of sort of a tea time setup. You can come in at this time and do a bit of shopping. And so a lot of the guardians, a lot of grandparents, parents, caretakers were able to come through and select new toys for the kids in their care, those that are loving on and serving. And so some 300 or more toys went out just on Friday evening to people here in the community, and you were a part of that. So thank you for your involvement in that. We're grateful for your ongoing generosity. You've been faithfully giving in the offering box back here to support the ministry of making disciples here on the South Shore. You've been giving electronically. We're grateful for that. So there's a lot of different ways you can be part of the worship of giving. We worship God with our lives and even with our tithes and offerings. And so there's ways of giving physically here, and there's ways of giving electronically. So you can text to give right through the church website. And so we're grateful for just your willingness to worship and to serve the Lord and to offer some of your resources back to him as a gratitude and as a sign of thanks to him. I want to pray, and then we're going to jump into the Gospel of John. We've been tracking through the Gospel of John. We're in the first chapter again this morning. We're looking at verses 35 through 42. We'll have them for you online, and we'll have them for you on the screens here this morning in person. Also, just wanted to plug that we're taking communion this morning, and so hopefully you had a communion packet on your way in. Guests online, church family members online, we're glad you could tune in. This is your church family. We're a church without walls. The auditorium is really massive right now. We're not constrained by any walls or a building here, but you can pause me right now if you want to go and grab some bread and some juice. We'll observe communion here at the conclusion of today's sermon. But let me pray. We're going to jump into God's word here in a moment. Father, we thank you for the opportunity of gathering here digitally and gathering together in person. We're thankful for the love that you have for us. We're thankful for what you're doing in our lives, and we're thankful for what you're doing in our nation and in the world. We rest in you today. We find our comfort in you today. We lean on you, and we find life and meaning and faith in you today and all days. And so, Father, we ask for your continued guidance. We lift up our nation, Father. We pray for just great unity and peace to come from coast to coast, from community to community, Father, that we would be united in big picture purposes, Father, that we could come together in our disagreements, that we could come together where we might part ways in conviction, Father, to love well, to be respectful to one another, to point many to you. So, Father, we ask for your guidance. Father, for those that have served in the military as veterans, Lord, we're grateful for their sacrifice. We're grateful for their service. Bless them and encourage them and their families, Father. We're thankful for this nation, Father. May we continue to point people to you, rallying together, seeking peace in you, life in you. Father, move in our time now as we turn to your word. Just give us guidance and encouragement. Empower us and move us forward as you see fit. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe you've experienced this with your kids or the kids you've been around, but often kids hit a stage in life where they ask a ton of questions, like lots of questions, rapid fire questions, like why is there grass? How does it grow? Cows eat grass, right? Why do they eat grass? Why are people bald? Just question on top of question. There's just this stage where they're just exploring and observing and learning more and learning more and learning more. Our kids are notorious for walking across the street to our neighbor's house when they see our neighbors outside doing projects, and they'll walk over there and they'll ask them question on top of question on top of question. What are you doing, Mr. Kurt? Why are you fertilizing your yard? What's going on here? And he'll lovingly just observe and receive the questions. And then he gets to the point where he says, hey, you know what? I don't know, but I bet your mommy knows, okay? Go ask your mom. Find your dad. I bet they know. Questions are a big part of our life. Children have questions. But it's not just a thing. Questions aren't just a thing for childhood. Many of you have questions today. In fact, many of you have questions that you've been wrestling with for years. Things that have sort of troubled you. Things that have challenged you that you've wrestled with, and you sort of stopped asking the questions because along the way, somehow, you were discouraged from discovery. You were discouraged from asking questions, and you just sort of smothered those things, and you've held them here kind of closely. Some of you grew up in environments where questions were not welcomed. Listen, we don't challenge, we don't ask, just sort of, this is what it is, we don't keep that to yourself, just keep pushing forward, you keep moving forward. But the reality is the questions that we have are really significant to us, and the questions that we have really direct our lives and develop and sort of shape our focus in life. And I want to tell you this morning that the God of the universe is not overwhelmed by your questions. You can approach him with the doubts, with the whys. And you can ask him, and you can approach and seek comfort in him. Some of us grew up in environments where it's like, listen, we don't ask because maybe there was a lack of desire from those in authority around us to dig into questions that are difficult. Maybe there was sort of trepidation over not knowing what to say or the right thing to say. The reality is God has all of the solutions and all of the answers for us. There's comfort in him. I would invite you to invite questions from your children. And I would encourage you to continue to bring your questions here to me and to the leadership team and to bring the questions you have to the community and certainly to the living God. He can handle it. Exploration is key. Questions are important and significant. Many of you have questions. Why do I exist? Like, do I exist just to sort of make money and retire and then I die? Like, why do we exist? Some of you are wrestling with questions over success. What does success look like? What does it look like to lead my business? What does it look like to lead my family? What does it look like to be a loving neighbor in the community? You've got questions. Some of you are asking, why am I not content? Why am I just internally wrestling, feeling discontent and sort of disconnected? Why? Your questions are significant. And two of Jesus' earlier followers had a question for Jesus, but the question they had was sparked by the question that Jesus had for them. And the question that Jesus asked Andrew and the Apostle John, I would argue, he offers and asks us today, and I think it's a phenomenal question for us to wrestle with and a phenomenal question for us to ponder at times in life. It comes to us from John chapter 1, verse 38. Jesus says this. I'm going to start here with the question, and then we're going to come back to the beginning in verse 35. But this is the question Jesus asked Andrew and the Apostle John. He says, what do you want? Now, initially, you might think Jesus is like, hey, buzz off. Quit asking me. Like, what's going on? Just sort of give me space. Why are you hounding? Why are you following me? But Jesus is asking this really in a tender way, and his framework is a question that invites reflection. He's asking us to ponder a bit more deeply about life. He's, in essence, saying, what are you looking for? Depending on your translation, it might say, what are you searching for? What are you seeking? What are you looking for? What do you want? But I think probably a good translation, in which is the title for today's sermon, is, what are you looking for? This isn't surface stuff. The God of the universe isn't a surfacey sort of a God. The God of the universe is a God that invites us to reflect and to think inwardly. He's saying, what's the trajectory of your life? What's your passion? What's your purpose? What's your agenda? What's your initiative? And that question here really will direct your footsteps. The things that you're about will determine your decisions. The things that you focus on will determine who you chill with and spend time with and the way you carry yourself. See, what are you looking for? Let's go back to verse 35, jumping back into the narrative here, and we'll work our way to the context of that question a little bit more. So here we are, verse 35. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. So this is John the Baptist. He's building into, we'll see here momentarily, Andrew, and my argument, as I've touched on, is that he's building into the Apostle John here in this moment, and he's with two of the followers that have been tracking with him. Now, John was there. John the Baptist was there to be a trailblazer. We touched on that, right? He was there to prepare the way for others to know Christ, to know the Messiah. And so he was getting others ready to receive Jesus. So you can imagine that he was going through the law and the prophets. He was building out and communicating truth and building a case and an argument that pointed to the reality of a Messiah that would come. so that when Messiah Jesus showed up, the people were ready to receive, ready to follow. Look at verse 36. When he saw, that is when John the Baptist saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." Remember last week we talked about that there is significance in names. We quoted Romeo and Juliet when Juliet says, "What's in a name?" And we determined that the names of Jesus have significance and they have depth, they have purpose, they have meaning. And so John there established this terminology that he references again here, the Lamb of God. We determined, we found, not from what I said, but based on what God said from his scriptures, that we all are sinful and we're broken. We're all in need of forgiveness. We're all in need of a Savior. And John established that God sent the Lamb, the Son of God, Jesus, the chosen one, our rescuer, to be the ultimate sacrifice, to be the ultimate Lamb of God, the ultimate Savior, the only Savior. He became our sacrifice. He became our substitute. And that he stood in our place, taking on a death that I deserve, a death that we all deserve. He became our substitute. And then we found that Jesus, the Lamb of God, was the satisfaction of the justice of God. God's wrath, his just wrath, is quenched and satisfied forevermore on your behalf to the work of Jesus, if you receive Jesus by faith. John now declares emphatically, confidently, that the Lamb of God is the one that was walking right before him. He knew it, he believed it, but it was affirmed by heaven at the baptism of Jesus the day before. John takes Jesus, the Savior, God in the flesh, God incarnate, and he takes Jesus and he dunks Jesus in water, bringing him in the water, foreshadowing the death that he would experience as he's dying, and he lays in the tomb, and then he's brought out of the water, resembling the resurrection that will come. And when Jesus comes out of the water, heaven opens up, the Holy Spirit descends upon Jesus and remains upon Jesus, and God the Father said, "This is my beloved Son, my chosen Son, in whom I am well pleased." Heaven's declared that Jesus is the Lamb. Now John, without hesitation, without any inkling of doubt, says, "There's the Lamb of God. There's your Savior. There's your rescuer. There's the one that can answer the deepest questions of your mind, the deepest sort of cravings of your soul. That is the one." And look what happens here, verse 37. When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. They heard the testimony of Jesus, and they get up and they follow. And you're thinking, like, what? It's crazy. So you're in the city, you're in the Boston Commons, right? And you're hanging out with a friend, and someone says, "Hey, this is a person of significance," right? And you just get up and you just sort of go with this person. Like, you just met them for a second, you hear something about them, and you're like, "Yeah, I'm all in. Where are we going?" It's a bit unnerving. It's a little bit out of care. Like, it's just sort of, it's unusual, it's interesting, but there's something happening here. There's something supernatural happening. This is a divine appointment. But I think something here, pushing that a bit more, there's another segment of this sort of puzzle, if you will. Not only is this a divine appointment of the movement of God, as God is calling followers to himself, John has been preparing the way, right? He has been a trailblazer, an influencer for Jesus. And what John was doing, he wasn't busy making disciples of John. He was busy making disciples of Jesus, so that when Jesus showed up, they were ready to track. They were ready to run. They were ready to explore. They were ready to learn more. John wasn't making disciples of himself. He was making disciples of Jesus. And as a result, they were ready to move and find and explore more and go with the Master. There's a battle in our lives about constantly sort of having Jesus on the throne, or Tim on the throne, or whoever you are, fill in the blank for your name. There's a temptation in seeking to make disciples of us. It would have been tempting for John the Baptist to build a huge crowd and build a thing unto his name. And we do find later in Acts, he did have followers. But I think it's much like the Apostle Paul that said, "Hey, you follow me as I follow Jesus. You imitate me as I imitate Jesus." John wasn't saying, "Hey, just come and be a little John." Come and follow and be more like Christ. Be a discipler. Be a disciple maker. Be a disciple of Jesus. Be an apprentice of Jesus. That's the ticket. It's to know Jesus, to make him known. It's to follow Jesus. Like I said, it's tempting to sort of make disciples of yourself. It'd be tempting to sort of make disciples of our business. Like, it would be tempting to sort of make disciples of a political leader or a political movement. And I think that's been going on for a long time on both sides, like all across the board, all parties and movements. What we're seeing is people are saying, look, come and follow this leader. Come and follow this movement. But the focus too often is on a temporal kingdom, not the king and his kingdom. My calling isn't to invite people into this relationship with a political leader or a movement. My calling and our calling is saying, look, we're going to be informed citizens. We're going to love well. We're going to live out our faith. We're going to be good neighbors. We're going to share the good news. We're going to live in the grace of Jesus. But ultimately, we're inviting people to something greater, to someone greater, to follow the master, the one that ushers in this everlasting kingdom, the one that can remove sin. Politics and sort of these things are important, but they're not eternally transformative. It's temporal, but the king is forever, and his kingdom is forever. Be involved, but may we point people mostly to Jesus. Let's be disciple makers of Jesus. Let's invite others to Jesus. My calling isn't to make disciples of Tim. That would be pretty sad. You'd be pretty bored. I would let you down time and time again. I'm not the Savior. I'm not flawless, not even close to it. Talk to my wife. She could give you a litany of stories about just this week, probably. I'm not about making followers of me. I'm about helping people find and follow Jesus. My calling isn't to hoard a bunch of people online or in person. My calling and invitation is to make much of Jesus, to point you to Jesus, to encourage your faith, and then to send you out to live on purpose so you can point others to Jesus. He's the one that will save your soul. He's the one that forgives. He's the one that will transform our community and our families. He's the one that has the ability to do some eternal transformative work in our nation. Let's make much of Jesus. Not much of ourselves. Humility, like, look, man, Jesus. He's the ticket. He's our hope. So they followed Jesus. Jesus knows that he is being followed. He's omniscient, all-knowing. He knows exactly what's happening. Turning around, Jesus saw them following, and he asked, what do you want? Some of us are looking for peace. Success, resources. We're looking for real life. What do you want? This may be a question you've asked yourself. What are you searching for? What do you want? This is a good one to mark in your phone or in your journal and just sort of come back to on occasion and just think, what am I looking for? What's my life about? Where am I investing my energy and my focus? Like, where am I tracking? Jesus says, what do you want? What are you searching for? And his question then sparks this question from his two new followers. And they said, Rabbi, which means teacher. This is honored one, significant one, impactful meaning, loaded with meaning. He says, where are you staying? Okay, wait a minute. God in the flesh, in their midst, face to face with God. And they basically say, Jesus, what's your address? Where are you staying? If you were in their shoes and you were in that moment, what would you have asked Jesus? I would have been like, hey, Jesus, articulate the meaning of life for us. Like, get like, or maybe even like, what happened to the dinosaurs? The kids are all, Daddy, what happened to the dinosaurs? Like, well, there's different theories. Like, where are you staying? That's the question. I want to invite you to ask questions of the master. I know we're not there centuries ago in the presence of, fully in the presence of Jesus like that, But you can seek the heart of Jesus. You can seek the heart of God. You can bring him your deep questions. Pray over them. Offer them to the King. And he'll provide guidance and comfort. There's some challenges, though, when asking questions, because the reality is many of you have these questions of why. Why did she die then? Why did he die then? Why do we see all of this evil and this corrupt? Like, why? We've got a lot of why questions, and the scriptures give a lot of comfort, provide great solutions, but there's a lot of personal questions you have and I have that we probably won't have an adequate answer for this side of the kingdom of heaven. So one of the challenges that you're going to face, that I've faced, that we're going to walk through is, how do we walk in a robust, thriving faith in the living God when we've got some questions? You're going to have questions. You've got questions now. And there will be these sort of things that happen where you're just wrestling and wondering, and we're not going to fully know. But we've got to rest in God's power. We've got to rest in God's promises. We need to rest in his character, because all of these things that we see about Jesus, about the living God in Scripture, align flawlessly and perfectly. And we need to rest in him even when we're just scratching our heads. But I invite you to wrestle, to ask, and to bring these questions to Jesus. You can ask him now. You can seek him in prayer. Bring them to him. So they're asking Jesus, where do you live? Now they're trying to figure out, they're observing, they're investigating if Jesus is the one. And so it's kind of lost, I think, a little bit in our culture, at least in my upbringing. And here what they're getting at is they're thinking, if they know where Jesus is staying, if they know the village he's in, if they can see the people that Jesus is interacting with at home, it'll be an indicator to them to let them know that, yeah, he's legit, or no, he's not. Names have a meaning, but the towns you come from, the streets you live on as well, they have meanings. Now, I wasn't a fan of the show. This isn't like I'm confessing like one of those like, you know, deep sort of like interests they have. So don't read into this. But when I was a kid growing up, there was a show, 90210. I'm not advocating the show or whatever. But just that zip code that meant something, Beverly Hills 90210, is a loaded zip code. You start to think about all of these things, fame and whatever. If you tell people you're from Charlestown, that means something. If you say you're from Southie, that means something. Marshfield, or if you're from Kenya, it means something. Where Jesus was staying meant something, and they thought it'd be an indicator to his legitimacy. So they wanted to know, where are you staying? Look what Jesus says. He says, verse 39, come, he replied, you will see. Hey, come on, guys. Follow me. I'll show you where I'm staying. I'll give you an indication to what I'm up to. You'll see where I'm camped out. Just come and see. Some of you are curious about Christ. You want to know more about this King. You're not quite yet convinced. You're not certain yet if you're ready to surrender and to fully follow him. You're not certain that you want to make him Lord and King of your life. And Jesus' invitation for those early followers rings true for us today. He says, come and see. So we invite you to continue to track with and to hear from God's word, and whether digitally in person, to come and explore and look into the scriptures so that you may be informed and that you may make a determination as well. Jesus says, you've got questions, you're searching, you're looking, you're seeking. Hey, come on. Come and follow me. Come pursue me. Come find life. I'll set you straight. So come, and you will see. So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. They got to hang out with Jesus for the day. I bet someone's asked you, hey, if you could spend the day with one person, who would you spend it with? Have you heard that? If you could have lunch with one person, who would you spend that lunch hour with? You're like, man, Tom Brady. We'd have kale salad and throw the pigskin around, of course. Like, I want to do that. They got to hang out with the God of the universe. Can you imagine the conversation, the teaching, the questions both ways that were posed and offered? Can you imagine that? The King is still saying, come and see. The Savior is still inviting you to rest in Him. He's still inviting us daily to be present with Him. You can pray to the King. You can confess your struggles and your sins to the King, right? You can offer, as we've talked about, questions you have to the God of the universe. He's still inviting us to come and to see and to be present with Him and to have a relationship with Him. I mean, that was the huge sort of thrust of the Lamb of God showing up, is that the God of the universe wanted to be with you and be with me and have a relationship in proximity with all of us, that there would be this vibrant, diverse, growing community together, united through Jesus in this eternal kingdom. God hasn't pulled away from you. He's not hiding Himself from you. He's saying, come and see. Come and be with me. Come and pursue me. You can speak to Him in prayer. You can look into God's Word for guidance. You can fellowship with this Savior. And one day in the future, our fellowship and relationship with the Savior will be marked by a flawless faith and will be marked by sight as we get to be in the presence of this great God, this great Savior. He invites them to come and see, and He invites us daily to connect with Him, to seek Him. Verse 40, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. Verse 41, the first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, we have found the Messiah, that is, the Christ. We have found Him. This experience for Andrew and the apostle John was so impactful that they had to run and tell somebody. They had this encounter with a living God, the one that was asking them what they're looking for, and they were finding satisfaction for their mind and their soul in Jesus. And there was this passion and urgency to go and tell other people that they had found the Savior, that they had found the Lamb of God, the Messiah, the anointed one that had been set apart before the foundation of the world. In eternity past, they had found that one that was going to come in the love of God, in a great rescue mission of God to give life. They had found Him. Andrew had to run after spending this time with Jesus to tell his brother Simon Peter. Urgency, intentionality, and this desire for Simon Peter to know the Lamb as well, to know the Savior as well. Andrew's not mentioned much in Scripture, maybe three times as far as I can remember. But every time Andrew's mentioned, he's bringing people to Jesus. He's pointing people to the hope of the universe, the hope of the world. They had this encounter, this God moment, this God interaction, and now they have the story to tell, and they're propelled forward to share it. He has this love and desire for his brother Simon to come to know the light, to know the Lamb, the chosen one. And he tells and he shares of the good news of this Jesus. In verse 42, he brought him to Jesus. Brings his brother right there to the hope of the world, to the feet of the King. May that be of us. May we be quick to tell those God stories, the things that God's doing in our lives, the things that He's teaching us. May we be quick where we can to share the good news of Jesus, the hope that we have, to share a testimony of what He's doing in and through us. Some of you are in positions in life where you can't freely just sort of share about what Jesus is up to in your life. It would be bad for your employment, and it just wouldn't be appropriate, but we can pray for those around us, and we can be prepared in those moments to be able to share the hope that we have through Jesus when they come. As we follow Jesus, we have to do it expectantly, knowing that if we want to follow Him and point others to Him, He'll give us those opportunities. So you may not have that free opportunity just to share about your faith or share about what God's teaching you, but you can pray for those, and you can model what Jesus has done for you with your life. You can live in such a way that just oozes love and compassion and mercy and is informed of truth. You may not be able to say it or preach it like I am called to do at times, but we're all able and called to model it, to live it, and to be prepared to share our stories. You have a story to tell. It's different than my story. And my story is different from yours. But your stories, those God stories, those faith stories, those God sort of merciful, gracious, compassionate stories that you have to tell are powerful. They're significant. What's your story? Pray through it and be prepared to share when you can. One other way we can point people to the Lord is to Tim, I don't know what to say. I'm not ready yet to be like Andrew and to go and just sort of preach and invite even a family member. That can be difficult to sort of come to the feet of Jesus. But I could invite somebody. I can invite someone to jump in with us online. I can invite them to come and gather with us at some point. So you can encourage, others can encourage and point people to the Lamb, point people to this God. We can live out our faith and we can be prepared to give a defense of it and to share the goodness of the story that God is writing in and through us. You have a story. Don't be afraid to wrestle with these questions. Bring them to Jesus for guidance, for comfort, for solution, and a way forward. When I was a younger guy, a younger kid, I didn't really appreciate U2, the music of U2. It was kind of sort of before my time, if you will. But as I've sort of progressed in life, I've sort of found a new appreciation for U2, for Bono. The Joshua Tree album is musically, it's pretty inventive, creative, and lyrically, it's thought-provoking. And there's a song there in the Joshua Tree album that says that I still haven't found what I'm looking for. I want to quote Bono for you. I'm not going to sing it, trust me. You'll tune out and leave real quick. But this is what Bono says in kind of that classic song. He says, I've climbed the highest mountains. I've run through the fields only to be with you. Only to be with you. I've run, I've crawled, I've scaled these city walls only to be with you. But I still haven't found what I'm looking for. A lot of us have great questions, deep questions. A lot of us have cravings of the soul, things we're pursuing, things that we're looking for, but we haven't found what we're looking for. We haven't found satisfaction yet because I think we're offering our questions to the wrong source. And we're pursuing things and seeking something from sources that can't provide the things that we need most. And that's forgiveness, that's love, that's peace. And I'm talking about eternal love, peace, and acceptance from God. I know a lot of my life I was unsettled and just sort of in a state of discontentment because I was looking for some good things. They weren't terrible things, they were just out of turn and they were in areas that couldn't satisfy. I want to end by just saying this. The deepest questions of your mind and of your life and the deepest cravings of your heart and soul are found and satisfied fully in Jesus Christ, in the Lamb of God. I'm not flawless by any stretch, as I joked that earlier. But by the grace of God, when I found God, because God ultimately found me and drew me to Him, new peace rushed in. New strength from outside of myself rushed in. Clarity began to come. Yeah, there are questions. I don't have it all figured out. But the greatest questions that I was wrestling with as a young man, I found great comfort and solution and answers to those deep questions in Jesus and in the Word of God. If you still haven't found what you're looking for, it's possibly because you haven't found Christ yet. But maybe today is that moment where you just say, Jesus, I do want to see. I do want to follow. I do want to find hope for my soul and forgiveness, and I believe it is you, and I'm going to place my faith in you. Jesus is the one. He'll satisfy your questions and satisfy the longing of your soul like no one else can, like no one else will. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your guidance and your goodness. We're thankful, God, that you are a loving God that invites us to yourself. You're a God that establishes yourself in our lives. You root yourself in our lives. And you come to give us guidance and to give hope and to give new life. It's all by your grace and all by your love. So, Father, we just turn to you today. We trust you as Lord and King. We ask you would guide us, that we would follow, know you better, and be energized in you, and be sent out to point others to you, that others would be encouraged by you, that others might come to know the truth of a loving God who died for them, rose for them, so that they, by faith, could be forgiven and entered into the kingdom of heaven. Be glorified, we ask, Lord. Bless your people, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Today we have the privilege of settling into this for a moment and continuing our worship experience. Just for a few more minutes, we're going to take communion together. And so hopefully on the way in, you were given a communion packet. We're trying to be touchless. It's juice in here. It's grape juice and a wafer just for those in the room. And those that are joining us online, we invite you to grab something now if you haven't. Some juice, some wine, some water, whatever it may be, some bread, a cracker, so we can reflect on the sacrifice of Jesus together. The first thing I want to say about baptism, we're not talking about baptism. We can talk about that. The first thing I want to say about communion and baptism, these are, I would say, the two key tenets, key aspects of the body of Christ, these exercises of worship, baptism, communion. Sometimes we look at baptism or communion as a means of rescuing and saving or cleansing of sins or giving us eternal life. But the reality is the scriptures teach that it's faith in Christ and faith in Christ alone that forgives, that gives us eternal life, that rescues. This is a moment of reflection, reflecting on what Jesus has done for you, the work of Christ on the cross for you. I want to tie in just for a moment of reflection here. We'll pray and we'll observe, and then we'll get to sing one more time before we dismiss. But I want to talk about the scapegoat. In the Old Testament, we see in Leviticus 19, this practice of a scapegoat. Really, it ties in with the reflection, the worship of Yom Kippur, but it's another conversation for another time. But there was this moment of worship where a bull and two goats would be offered. The bull would be sacrificed, and then there were these two goats, and they would cast lots, kind of like throwing dice, to determine which of the goats would be sacrificed. Aaron would work through this process of slaying the bull and one of these goats, and that blood was shed to help atone, to cleanse the sins of the people of Israel before the ultimate scapegoat to come. So there was this cleansing taking place, and there was this sacrifice offered that would bring fellowship and intimacy, again, between God's people and God. But all of it was a precursor to the ultimate scapegoat, Jesus. There's this other goat there that Aaron would lay his hands upon, and he would pray over, and he would actually confess all of the sins that were brought to his memory of the people. And the hands were symbolically laid on this scapegoat, and the scapegoat was taken far out into the wilderness. The idea is that this one was removing the sins of the people, taking it far, far away. And they would bring that scapegoat all the way out to the wilderness to a rocky, jagged area so that it could not easily return. And that scapegoat would pass away as well. All of the symbolic of atoning of sin, all of it pointing us to Jesus, who's our ultimate scapegoat. He's the flawless one, the perfect one, without blemish, without error, the ultimate sacrifice, the once and for all sacrifice and scapegoat. God the Father, in mercy, laid our sins and corruption on Jesus, the scapegoat. And he had the ability and made provision to take our sins far away so that we might, by faith in Jesus, be made right with God. Not for a little while. Not until the next goat was sacrificed, the next bull was sacrificed, and that next goat was sent out. Jesus is it. So I'm inviting you, if you haven't, to place your faith in Jesus, the one that takes all of our sin and shame, all of our evil, all of our brokenness upon himself, dying, rising on the third day, so that by faith in him we could be forgiven and be right with God. That is the invitation. And this morning, for those that have tracked with Jesus and have surrendered to him by faith, we're reflecting on his great sacrifice today, his great death, and certainly his resurrection. In 1 Corinthians, we see this, chapter 11, verse 23, as we turn our attention to receive communion together. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Verse 24, Paul continues, "And when he had given thanks, he broke it, said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Verse 25, "In the same way, after supper, he took the cup." Jesus takes the cup, and he says, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Jesus has died. He's shed his blood for us. His sacrifice atones, removes our sins so we might be right with God, so we might have fellowship with God. We reflect on his sacrifice today, and we live out of his sacrifice. We seek to forgive others as he's forgiven us. We seek to be peacemakers as he sought to reconcile and make peace for us through Jesus. And we seek to live out of this unwavering love for us from Jesus as we extend it to others. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your shed blood. We're grateful for the life that we have through your Son Jesus, the ultimate scapegoat, our ultimate sacrifice. Father, we thank you for making a way for us to be right. Thank you for bringing us to life. God, now we walk freely without shame, without worry, knowing that we're positioned with you for eternity based on what you've provided for us. God, we long to be with you, to know you more deeply, to walk closely with you. We ask for your guidance now, your blessing upon all tuning in, everyone here with us, that you'd encourage, that you'd empower, that you'd deepen our faith. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for making a way for us to be with you now and for eternity. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So now we have the opportunity to respond. We're going to sing one more time. So thankful to have you guys in the house today and online with us. We pray that you have a great week. Let's sing one more time. God bless you. Thanks.
As we close today, let us remember that we serve a God who has given everything for us. He sent his only Son to lay down his life on our behalf that we may have hope, a hope that this world cannot give. Let's worship and praise him as we close the service today. God bless each and every one of you. Go in peace.